Hurricane preparedness. Are you ready for a storm? When was the last time you checked your roof? Windows? Are those overgrown fruit trees pruned? What about the essential supplies like batteries, flashlight, food, medicine? Get your house in order. We had a close call during the past few days. Thankfully, Gonzalo or Hannah didn't hit. We talk hurricane preparedness and other important issues on today's edition of Jamaica Magazine. I'm Adrian Atkinson. Stay with us. The show begins right now.
Hurricanes can strike at any time. In the event of one, be prepared to act quickly. If a hurricane watch or warning has been issued, review your home disaster response plan. Map out likely routes to evacuate if your home is at risk and confirm with relatives or friends you plan to stay with. Also, confirm the location of the nearest shelter. Check your emergency supplies and restock if necessary. Remember, disasters do happen, so be prepared.
I'm Lorraine Mendez, and this is your JIS News for Tuesday, July 28. Government will be putting additional safety measures in place for the operation of daycare facilities before they are allowed to fully reopen. That announcement from Acting Director of Emergency Medical Services in the Ministry of Health and Wellness, Dr. Curdell Espinosa-Campbell. She was addressing a digital town hall hosted by the Ministry of Local Government and Community Development on July 23. Daycare centers have been allowed to resume operations for an initial two-week period from July 21 to 31 once they are in full compliance with COVID-19 protocols stipulated by the ministry. Dr. Espinosa-Campbell says while childcare operators generally take great care to ensure their facilities are properly sanitized, there are still some challenges that need to be addressed. She says the environmental health team at the ministry will have to sit down and define some clear parameters for full reopening, taking into account the different stages of development of children at these facilities. On the heels of a United Nations report that Jamaica stands to suffer great economic fallout from COVID-19's impact on tourism, Portfolio Minister Edmund Bartlett says government is working hard to mitigate that as much as possible. According to the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, UNCTAD, Jamaica is estimated to lose 11% of GDP as prevailing lockdown measures, travel restrictions, reductions in consumers' disposable income, and low confidence levels slow down tourism's recovery. But Tourism Minister Edmund Bartlett says the administration is fighting to hold its ground and overcome all odds.
The test of our mettle is far more pronounced this time than at any other time in our recent history, as the coronavirus, COVID-19, is the most devastating pandemic that we have had to face.
Minister Bartlett was speaking at the recent launch of the annual Christmas in July trade show. The 2020 staging of the event featured 142 manufacturers and artisans showcasing souvenirs and gift ideas to potential buyers.
So I'm particularly pleased that the small and medium tourism enterprises have been dominating this event because it was conceptualized with them in mind. I want to see small and medium enterprises taking control of supplying or large tourism investors with the products and services they need for their hotels and other properties to function at their best.
Tax Administration Jamaica, TAJ, has rolled out an online payment option for the renewal of driver's license. This came on stream on July 27, and the TAJ says it's part of an ongoing drive to expand online service offerings and promote contactless business transactions. Taxpayers can now pay the renewal fee for private, general, and motorcycle classification of license at jamaicatax.gov.jm using a valid credit card or other bank cards that have credit card features. Once payment has been made, customers will be able to generate their official receipt from the system. To complete the process, after finalizing the online payment transaction, persons are required to submit to any tax office a printed copy of their receipt, the application for driver's license transactions, form F7, and a passport-sized photograph. While the renewed license is being processed, motorists will be allowed to operate a motor vehicle using the receipt as proof of payment, along with their current or expired driver's license. This will be for a period not exceeding 60 days. Local Government Month youth runner Raheem Powell and his family are now recipients of a new house. The two-bedroom furnished house was handed over to the family on Friday. Young Raheem gained the attention of the media when he participated in the November 2018 youth run barefooted. The local government ministry subsequently learned of his unsatisfactory living conditions and decided to provide him with a house.
What young Raheem did is an indication of what kind of man he is going to be when he grow up and have his own family, because he's a family oriented man.
The ministry has provided Raheem with assistance in several areas since 2018, including getting his birth certificate and having him enrolled in educational programs. And finally, the National Parenting Support Commission is urging parents and guardians to participate in its virtual information sessions, which are geared towards assisting them with their children's return to school for the 2020-2021 academic year. The sessions are being facilitated via Zoom. They will enable parents to explore the schooling modalities and blended approaches that have been approved by the Ministry of Education. These include the rotational, extended day, and whole day approaches, along with homeschooling and online learning. The sessions, being held across the ministry's six regions, got underway on July 25 in Region 1, which incorporates Kingston and St. Andrew. Other sessions are scheduled for Region 3 on August 4, Region 4 on August 8, Region 5 on August 11, and Region 6 on August 15 at 6:30 p.m. each day. All forums are being staged in partnership with the Ministry of Education and the National Parent Teachers Association of Jamaica. Interested persons are asked to direct all queries to Sonia Oregio via email at sonia.oregio@moey.gov.jm or by calling 876-967-7977. And that's it for JIS News today. I'm Lorraine Mendez. Thanks for watching.
Next, the major assignments of Prime Minister Andrew Holness during the past week. Take a look.
States of emergency extended, Education Transformation Commission launched, and 20 garbage trucks handed over to the National Solid Waste Management Authority. You're watching Jamaica House Weekly. I'm Anthony Morgan.
We are committed to creating a safer, healthier, and secure working environment for our police force as it pursues its mission to serve, protect, and reassure.
Prime Minister Andrew Holness, as he officially opened the Port Antonio Police Station and Divisional Headquarters Friday. The initially $104 million project was completed for just under $92 million. Upgrading works include the demolition and reconstruction of the Divisional Headquarters, the station, the living quarters, cell area, kitchen, and other amenities. Mr. Holness says the project falls under a police station upgrade program funded by the National Housing Trust. Of the $2 billion set aside, $662 million has been committed for this financial year, with $450 million already spent. Ongoing projects set to be completed this year include Harmon Barracks, as well as the Buff Bay and Olympic Gardens police stations. While in Portland Friday, the Prime Minister opened the new East Palm Bridge in the parish. The new $24.3 million bridge serves the East Palm community and adjoining areas, including Prospect, Crossroads, David Lane, Boystown, Johnstown, and Land Settlement. It replaces a 70-year-old bridge that was ordered closed by the National Works Agency in November 2015.
The government of Jamaica remains committed to improving infrastructure island-wide to strategically increase connectivity around the island, reduce travel time and wear and tear on our vehicles, and to ensure the connectivity and productivity of our urban centers so that people can move across Jamaica seamlessly.
Prime Minister Andrew Holness also announced plans to upgrade 13 bridges in the parish as part of works to be completed under the Southern Coastal Highway Improvement Project. Mr. Holness used his visit to Eastern Jamaica to witness the progress being made on the Southern Coastal Highway Improvement Project. In Kingston Thursday, the Prime Minister handed over 20 new garbage trucks to the National Solid Waste Management Authority, NSWMA. The trucks are expected to improve garbage collection and improve the environment.
It is a major achievement that the government is serious about increasing the fleet and therefore increasing the service. This government is 100% focused on what matters for transformation.
Municipal corporations in St. James, Clarendon, the corporate area, and Portmore will each receive two trucks. The other parishes will each receive a unit, while the remaining trucks will be used for commercial collection. Wednesday saw the Prime Minister launching the island's high-level commission on education transformation. The 14-member commission is tasked with conducting an extensive review and assessment of Jamaica's education system to include its structure and operations. The commission is also expected to recommend actions for change. A report with those recommendations is to be ready by March 2021. The newly formed commission is chaired by Professor Orlando Patterson, a Harvard University sociology professor.
We have assembled a comprehensive group that represents all elements of the education system. I am truly grateful to all the members of the commission who have agreed to serve. What I am looking for is not tinkering or tweaking, but real radical change that will put Jamaica on an entirely new trajectory to growth and prosperity.
In Parliament Tuesday, the Prime Minister made a case for the extension of 10 states of emergency now in operation across the island. He said that based on police statistics, the enhanced security measure had assisted in an overall 13% reduction in crime across the island. This average reflected decreases in the figures for murders, shootings, rape, robberies, and break-ins.
It is clear that the SOEs work, that in all instances, we can say without question that lives have been saved.
48 of the 63 members of Parliament supported the passage of the Prime Minister's extension resolution.
This was proposed as a small project that could have a big impact given the high levels of traffic and congestion in this section of Camp Road and the vicinity. There are too many crashes here, and it was clear that the contributory causes relate to the road layout, which resulted in not only accidents, but insufficient queuing space for cars waiting to enter Upper Camp through the main gate.
Prime Minister Andrew Holness, as he officially opened the Jamaica Defense Forces Cannonball Gate entrance last Tuesday. The construction of the new gate forms part of a program to improve the road layout, drainage, water and sewerage, and ICT infrastructure along a section of Camp Road. Completed at a cost of $5.37 million, the project was executed by China Harbor Engineering Company through a partnership with the JDF and National Works Agency. The 19th Century Cannonball Monument, which was erected to commemorate the 3rd West India Regiment, has also been restored and posted at the gate. And that's it for Jamaica House Weekly. Be sure to join us next time for the latest stories coming out of the Office of the Prime Minister.
Are you a small to medium-sized tourism enterprise? Borrow up to $25 million at an interest rate of 5%. You can use the funding to develop and maintain your infrastructure, upgrade or increase your capacity, enhance and expand your attraction, tour or event, and purchase raw material. Call the Exim Bank and ask about the Tourism SMTE loan. Their numbers are 876-630-1400 or 876-618-5889. Tap into the over $3 billion US dollars earned yearly through tourism with a SMTE loan.
Jamaicans 75 years and older are mandated to stay home as those in that age group are more vulnerable to serious symptoms from COVID-19. But seniors at home are not left alone. They can call into the relevant agencies to have their critical needs taken care of. Watch this.
The late South African leader Nelson Mandela once said, A society that does not value its older people denies its roots and endangers its future. Let us strive to enhance their capacity to support themselves for as long as possible, and when they cannot do so anymore, to care for them. It's a message with renewed significance in this COVID-19 fight. Adults 60 years and older are listed among the most vulnerable to be impacted severely by the novel coronavirus. Protecting them requires deliberate action. The Jamaican government, through the Ministry of Local Government and Community Development, has taken lead on this by providing access to medical care, food, and sanitation supplies.
All persons 75 years and older must stay at home. The established studies that have been done around it suggest that the susceptible group, the group that is most affected in a critical way, are our seniors, 65 years and above. They will be allowed to conduct the essentials of life, but under certain restrictions. This is not isolating them, locking them off. This is a little bit of social distancing, but it is not social isolation. All right? Still call them on the phone, go and look for them, carry food, make sure they're all right, keep engaging them. But remember that if you are young and healthy and you get the disease, the probability of you recovering is far greater than the probability of your grandparent or even your parent. And you may not even show symptoms. You may have a slight cold, as they say, and you recover, but you are transmitting. You are still carrying the disease, and you go and you hug up grandma, and poor grandma gets sick, and it was all because of you.
While government implements that policy to keep older adults at home, it is making sure their needs are not neglected. So the local government ministry has set up the Rona Helpline Senior Care Response Initiative. It is designed to aid senior citizens over the age of 70 years old who are in critical need. The ministry is executing the program through the Social Development Commission. The Rona Helpline Senior Care Response Initiative works by establishing contact points for senior citizens. Seniors may call in to the contact points requesting assistance to complete critical services they may need while being indoors. Concierge services being done on behalf of the seniors include filling prescriptions, grocery shopping, and transportation to health facilities for urgent care. The transportation and logistics costs for the critical supplies are free to the seniors. They pay for the cost of the groceries or medications, but not to have it delivered to their doorsteps. There are 16 contact point offices island-wide. The main one is headquartered at the local government ministry, while the other 15 locations are SDC parish offices. These contact points manage and coordinate the island-wide response to the elderly population. Seniors may call in to the contact points with their specific needs from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. Mondays to Fridays. Officers and volunteers will screen calls to ensure the validity of the requests. The SDC's officers will then mobilize to fulfill the urgent needs of the seniors. In addition, if necessary and based on the assistance required, reliable individuals are dispatched to the home of the elderly person to provide the specific support requested. Beating COVID-19 by providing a senior care response is a priority for the Jamaican government. If you are a senior citizen and you are in need of such assistance, call the Rona Helpline at 876-618-8218. 876-879-8948 or 876-879-8950. You may also call the SDC's parish office in your area.
If you did not catch the number for your parish, the contact points numbers are listed on the social media pages of the local government ministry and the SDC.
Mr. Jones.
And your colleagues, how will they look at an abuser? When the law comes knocking, you'll have nowhere to run.
Mr. Brown, you're under arrest. Please get up, hands behind your head, and interlock your fingers.
Turn your back on abusers. Report gender-based violence to the police. There's no excuse for abuse. Call the Bureau of Gender Affairs at 876-754-8577.
As we look forward to the Emancipation Weekend, let's remind ourselves of the struggles endured by our forefathers, those who paved the way for us to achieve certain freedoms today, such as the right to vote. Up next, the triumphant warrior, Daddy Sharp.
It was Christmas time in 1831. And Samuel Sharp, an educated Creole slave and a deacon at the Burchell Baptist Church in Montego Bay, was fine-tuning the plans for the first sit-down labor strike in Jamaica.
It was a master plan. It was a bold plan. It was way ahead of its time. And it was done in circumstances which were threatening and difficult because there was no freedom. And because the laws said it was okay for men to be slaves, for people to be slaves, so there's nothing on their side except way over in England, some emancipators. Because even their missionaries were telling them, take it easy, don't do anything. Remember the Bible says, submit to your masters and be quiet and content. You know, so there was nothing on their side except this feeling that this obscenity had to end with their generation and not going any further.
The plan was to have an all-island sit-down strike by slaves at the end of the three-day Christmas holidays between December 25 and December 27. It was the ideal time, as the sugarcane crop would be ready for harvesting by then, and if it wasn't reaped quickly, the crop would spoil. To lose a whole crop of cane spelled certain economic disaster for the island, which depended heavily on sugar as the main income earner. Sam Sharp believed that the planters would be compelled to negotiate freedom and salaries for the slaves returned to work.
What Sam Sharp said, you know, we're going to sit down quietly and we're not working again until they pay us. And somebody asked him, but what if they force us, if they try to force us to work? He says, then you have to make up your mind. Either you're going to fight or what? But there was that down the road if the thing didn't work.
The plan of passive resistance didn't work. On December 27, the Kensington Estate Great House was set on fire. It was felt that several slaves, drunk from the lavish distribution of rum during the merry season, started the fires. The destruction and the terrible loss of lives on that day and ensuing months have gone down in the pages of history as the Christmas Rebellion. Sam Sharp's freedom campaign never turned out the way he planned. He gave himself up to the authorities in a bid to end the slave killings and accepted responsibility for the rebellion, even though a number of actions were taken that did not meet with his approval. He was found guilty of inciting rebellion and administering unlawful oaths.
How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book.
I would rather die upon yonder gallows than live in slavery.
His tremendous courage was seen even to the point of death when he was hanged on the 23rd of May at the age of 31 years.
Is all I ever had. Redemption songs. Redemption songs. Redemption songs.
It doesn't matter that the whole of the legal system said it was okay, and that even some of the churches felt it was all right. As far as they were concerned, it was a violation of humanity and of the compact between man and God, and it had to end. And I think the whole question of how he went about mobilizing the people against this great evil in the face of what was almost certain death if they failed is something that we have to be very, very appreciative of.
Daddy Sharp, as his followers affectionately called him, is now seen as the predecessor of the trade union movement as he fought for the labor rights of slaves. Sam Sharp's life holds many valuable lessons for Jamaicans today. Although born in poverty, regarded as nothing more than an inanimate object by society, he taught himself to read, argued constructively, and presented himself always as a man of honor. This man of remarkable intellect, courage, and physical and moral authority succeeded in imparting his vision to more than 20,000 slaves in 5 parishes, instilling in them the desire to fight for the freedom so many of us enjoy today. It was his selflessness which propelled Sam Sharp to hero status in 1975. A monument to his self-sacrifice now stands in the heart of Montego Bay in a square named in his honor. Sam Sharp, freedom fighter, martyr, national hero.
Yell yard man, the yard man down, respect. I man to a yard. I respect and love man to all Jamaica, no matter where in the world. One eye, that guy won you.
No matter where in this world I go, I am a Jamaican. No birth papers I have to show, cause I am a Jamaican. No matter where in this world I go, I am a Jamaican. No birth papers I have to show, cause I am a Jamaican. I have Jamaican walk, them here Jamaican talk, cause I am a Jamaican. Them here Jamaican chat, them say Jamaican bop, cause I am a Jamaican. Now everywhere in this world I go, I am a Jamaican. I know ID I will have to show, cause I am a Jamaican. Them say Lord what a boy can run, that is a Jamaican. Rasta man from Jamdong, that is a Jamaican. Dressmaker, baker, tailor, shoemaker, market, woman in a donkey cart. Rivers and streams, fountains and mountains, in a Jamaica we have it all. Now when we're in the world I go, I am a Jamaican.
The show has come to an end, but only on your television screen. Do join us online on Facebook, Instagram, or YouTube for more features on a variety of issues. Then, again tomorrow at this same time on this same station, we'll have more updates for you. Until then, I'm Adrian Atkinson. Walk good.
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.